It's always a little awkward when the prayer is a hard act to follow. I feel like we just all go home right now. But we won't. No hymn is more inspiring than the wind rustling the leaves of the deep forest. No sanctuary more hallowed than the sun-touched mountains. No prayer of praise more glorious than the sweep of birds before the morning sun. The holy lives all around us. The sacred grows beneath our feet. Creation writes its own testimony of faith, presenting us each day with a reason to believe and a mission to fulfill. Here on this brilliant blue planet, on this emerald ball dancing before the stars, is our temple, our place of worship, our spiritual home, our once and future heaven. Bright morning star of the rising, bright morning star of the rising, bright morning star of the rising, gazing in my soul. The light is going to go back to the world. If I climb in there, we'll have to sing. No such luck. Please rise in body or in spirit. That's where I'm standing. Picked it up a notch and turned it into this kind of movement anthem. Bright morning star, just one arises for each other.
Bright morning star arising, bright morning star arising, bright morning star arising, days of bringing my soul.
There's a wonderful harmony to be found in this tune, and I love what Pete Seeger used to say about harmony. He said, harmony is any note that your neighbor isn't singing.
Bright morning star arising, bright morning star arising, bright morning star arising, days bring in my soul.
For justice and compassion.
For justice and compassion. For justice and compassion. For justice and compassion. For peace in every nation, for peace in every nation, for peace in every nation, days breaking in my soul.
For the healing of creation,
for the healing of creation, for the healing of creation. For the future of our children,
for the future of our children,
for the future of our children, days break in my soul.
That's my bright morning star.
Bright morning star arising, bright morning star arising, bright morning star arising, days break in my soul.
He's also the minister for climate justice at Arlington Street Church in Boston and has been a Unitarian Universalist parish minister for nearly two decades. In October 2015, he left parish ministry to devote his energies to creation, care, and climate advocacy. We are delighted he was able to come lead our service this morning. Following the service, Reverend Fred will have information downstairs at the climate justice table.
Oh,
believers in Cedar, Hayes, and Gilbert. The believers did a lot to launch the folk revival of the 1950s and 1960s that I grew up with, shaped me as a person I was actually introduced to the world of politics and current events by listening to the topical songs the believers and others sang. So I feel very much part of that river of tradition. I saw a sign the other day. Well, I didn't exactly see it. I saw it on Facebook, which is as close to seeing as many of us get. Anyway, someone had taken a picture of the sign and posted it on Instagram, and someone else posted it on Facebook, and then a Facebook friend of mine, who I probably wouldn't recognize if they showed up at my front door, posted it on their timeline. And so it appeared on my computer screen, and I saw it. It was the kind of sign you might see outside a general store or a muffler shop with the hand-placed letters, which in this case spelled out, humans are 90% water. Basically, cucumbers with anxiety. And I thought that was kind of funny and pretty true. So I posted it on my timeline. And immediately another Facebook friend, probably wouldn't recognize it if they showed up at my front door, posted a comment pointing out that actually the human body is only 60% water. So of course I had to Google human body percent water and found out they were right. 60%, give or take. But since we're in the realm of metaphor here, and human beings, whatever our percentage of water, are not literally cucumbers, unless we're using literally in the new non-literal sense. Whereby literally means not literally, literally, but kind of, sort of, literally, I'm just saying, sounds good, that kind of literally. In which case, we are literally cucumbers. But the exact percentage of water in our bodies isn't really as important as the metaphor, which rings true to me. Speaking only for myself. I aspire to the serenity of a cucumber. With awareness. Awareness carries terrible burdens. Climate change is upon us. And its first victims are the most vulnerable people on the planet. Mostly poor and of color. Last year, 2016, was the hottest year in recorded history, breaking the record set in 2015, which broke the record set in 2014. This past July, Dead Horse, Alaska, reached 85 degrees Fahrenheit, a new record. Arctic sea ice last summer was reduced to the lowest levels ever recorded. The permafrost is melting, which could release billions of tons more carbon into the warming atmosphere. Also in July, 13 people died in Louisiana in what should have been a 500-year flood, that is, of a magnitude experienced just once every 500 years. Except it was the 8th 500-year flood across the South in the last 12 months. The death toll from yesterday's flood in Colombia is approaching 200. And climate change is implicated there too. Last year, the prestigious science journal Nature warned that melting Antarctic ice could raise sea levels more than 6 feet by the end of this century, twice what was previously predicted, with devastating consequences for coastal populations. Bill McKibben, who 5 years ago taught us global warming's terrifying math, looked at the latest numbers last fall and found them even more frightening. To avoid catastrophic climate change, McKibben explained, we have to stop all new digging and drilling for fossil fuels and building pipelines to move them, because the mines and oil and gas fields currently in operation operation worldwide already contain enough carbon to cook the planet. From now on, declared McKibben, anyone proposing a new pipeline, coal mine, or oil well is effectively a climate denier. And while we're trying to put out the fire, President Trump is throwing gasoline on it, fast-tracking the Keystone XL and Dakota Access pipelines, and appointing a climate denier like Scott Pruitt to obstruct the mission of the very agency he now heads. You know, I still believe our fellow citizens are, by and large, basically good and decent people. We want to do the right thing. We want to help. There are entire professions and institutions whose mission is to help the Coast Guard, firefighters, first responders risk their lives. Many would give their lives to save mine or yours. And all of us, any of us, if we saw a child whose life was in danger, wouldn't we help? Wouldn't we do something? At least call 911 or maybe do something heroic ourselves. Because if we didn't, the child would die. And yet how many children will die from climate change and the drought, flooding, storms, famine, displacement, and disease? And these same good, decent, sometimes heroic Americans don't do anything about it. There are a lot of reasons. Ignorance, disinformation, helplessness, overwhelm, despair, numbness, addiction to the conveniences and distractions of hypercapitalism. In the throes of addiction, not one of us thinks clearly. It's as if when we call for help to save the life of a child, the people who hear us are intoxicated. So out of it, they can't think, let alone act. If we wait for them to hit bottom, that bottom will be a mass grave. Somehow, we have to break the trance and call our neighbors and ourselves into consciousness. The climate crisis is solvable. Solutions are all around us. Wind, solar, conservation, efficiency, smart growth, smart infrastructure, bioagriculture, eco-restoration. All around us. Personal transformation, community transformation, institutional transformation, and political transformation go hand in hand. None can succeed without the rest. We must be bolder, smarter, more creative, more faithful than ever before. Last September, I was arrested a second time in civil disobedience protesting the fracked gas pipeline under construction in West Roxbury, a neighborhood in Boston where residents are worried about potential leaks and explosions, as well as about the pipeline's contribution to global warming. In solidarity with the Standing Rock Sioux and their struggle against the Dakota Access Pipeline, 10 of us obstructed construction in West Roxbury by either sitting on the edge of the trench or climbing into it. The workers kept their distance, but firefighters and police officers, of course, came close enough to remove and then arrest us. We thank them for their work. One of them replied softly, "Thank you for your service." They live there too. Their families live there too. They don't want the pipeline either. Before the action, 70 of us gathered for interfaith worship at Theodore Parker Church in West Roxburgh. We shared our grief for the earth and all those suffering upon it. We prayed and we sang. Singer-songwriter Brian Cale performed his song, Praise Be the Ragtime Man. Praise be the ragtime band. Praise be the rambler's thumb. Praise be the mislaid plan. Praise be the flood if it comes. Praise be the ragtime band. Praise be our mislaid plan. My eyes are dry and they are open. I keep my grief in my hands. Praise be the flood if it comes. How do we praise the flood? How do we praise the flood that wreaks destruction, drowns our neighbors, and sweeps away everything in its path? What if the flood is the breaking of the water in the birth of a new world? What if the cries of creation are the labor pains of the birth of a new creation, a new society, a new way of being with each other and with ourselves, a way of compassion, a way of kindness, a way of justice, a way of healing? What if the election of Donald Trump is an organ failure in the necessary death of systems, assumptions, norms, beliefs, traditions, aversions, addictions that no longer serve us, if they ever did, that do not serve life on this planet? Valerie Kaur is an Indian American, a Sikh, a civil rights lawyer, and a mother. What if, she asks, what if this darkness is not the darkness of the tomb, but the darkness of the womb? What if our America is not dead, but a country still waiting to be born? What if this is our great contraction before we birth a new future? Remember, Kaur tells us, remember the wisdom of the midwife. Breathe. Breathe, then push. Climate champion Tim DeChristopher reminds us our old model of trying to meet all of our emotional needs with consumer goods hasn't worked. It hasn't made us happy anyway. Maybe greed and competition weren't the best values to be basing our society on. Activist filmmaker Josh Fox adds, the values we will need to survive are deep inside of us, waiting to come out. Courage, resilience, innovation, art, creativity, culture, generosity, community, human rights, democracy, the love of our fellow human beings. Those are the things climate can't change. And those are the things we do together. The morning after Donald Trump was elected, Methodist pastor Steve Garness Holmes wrote, when the temple falls, we are awakened from the illusion that the world is just fine. We finally know what others have known all along. We are vulnerable. We are exposed to the cynicism, violence, greed, and hatred of the world. From the Roman Empire to the Holocaust to today's unarmed young black men, or the people of Aleppo, or refugees, or the trafficked and exploited, they know. They know. There is no guarantee of justice. No illusion that everything will be right. The whole world is at risk. The whole world, there's no refuge. There never has been. Not even in beautiful North End or sophisticated Cambridge where I live. Gardner's Holmes continues, when the temple falls, what do? When we can't look to our power structures, what do? We become the temple. Ourselves. When the temple falls, we become the resurrection. We let ourselves be raised. We let ourselves be changed. Give voice to your pain, says Gardner Holmes, and let it rise as courage. Love this world with all you have. Connect with each other. Connect with strangers. Notice beauty. Work for justice. Live what really matters. So I invite you to imagine in your mind's eye a 4-year-old child. Doesn't matter who it is. Maybe it's a girl in the Marshall Islands in the Pacific. Maybe it's a boy in an urban neighborhood in Sudan. Maybe they live here in the United States on the Gulf Coast or Long Island. Maybe she looks a little like your granddaughter. Maybe he reminds you of your best friend when you were a kid. Imagine the shy smile on this child's face. Imagine this child playing with friends. Imagine this child in the tender embrace of parents. Now imagine that it's up to you whether this child suffers, whether this child is in pain, whether this child dies from famine or drought or storm. Drowning in flood that sweeps away her house, poisoned by contaminated water, or starving in a refugee camp. Now imagine this same child growing up happy, well-nourished, sustained by family and community, with renewable energy, equal opportunity, and a voice in democratic government. These are the two futures before this child, before all of us. Which future is real is up to us. Organizations right here in Massachusetts are doing important work to bring about the transition to the safe, sustainable future. Three of the best are 350 Mass, Mothers Out Front, and Climate Exchange. Information about all three will be available after the service. And if you want to learn more, I invite you to leave your name on the sign-up sheets with your contact information. The sign-up sheets on the books. Now, is it too late to stop climate change? Of course it is. The damage has already begun. Some of it may be irreversible. Many will die. Many have died already. But it is never too late to save the next life or the next species. It is never too late to offer love to our neighbor or even our enemy. Never too late to feed the hungry. Never too late to welcome the stranger, to heal the sick, to visit the prisoner. It is never too late to change. My friends, there is no birth without death. In the Christian story, there is no resurrection without crucifixion. Everything is interconnected. All beings are our relation. We are not victims of the flood. We are the flood. We are running waters, says Lakota activist Chase Ironmonger, seeking a way, cutting fresh courses when spring swells us with power. We move mountains and break banks, creating. May we cut fresh courses. May we swell with power. May we move mountains and break banks until justice rolls down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream.
This is where we are called to be unified. The tide is rising.
love every leaf, every ray of God's light. Love the animals, love the plants, love everything. If you love everything, you will perceive the divine mystery in things. And you will come at last to love the whole world with an all-embracing love.